All right, welcome everybody to the December 5th, 2016 School Committee meeting. I'll call the meeting to order at whatever, 6:03. And let's take a look at the minutes of November 7th.
So moved.
Second.
Second, any discussion? All in favor? Aye. Financial statements.
So I emailed you the reports and I don't have any concerns at this moment. We are in good shape. We do have 6 warrants to sign tonight.
I didn't get the financial reports.
Are you kidding, Katie? I sent them out last week and I sent out both reports the way you like to see it.
I didn't believe it.
You know what though, Patty, I had a couple of questions.
Okay.
I thought I had them with me.
Yeah.
I noticed some of the salaries are running already over.
Okay, like where?
Clerical and under the principal's office.
Okay, so right now it looks like we're only about $1,100 over and that we will get clearer because we have a budget and I don't always do Lola. One of our clericals is not, her hours are part year. So I basically do it because I don't know where the payroll cutoff is yet. And when I figure out when we will pay her last few days, once we have the snow days, then I correct it. Because then I'll know when I get closer, will she be done on the 7-1 payroll or the 7-14 payroll?
Okay.
So that could, so I'm not concerned about that because that's just me with my accounting until I get through winter.
Okay, and then you had almost $4,000 in hardware devices. Page 3.
Yes, so so that is something that Pete and Scott had purchased. They wanted to make a purchase. So Pete now knows that he's got to find that $3,998 and not overspend another line because he's got to move his purchase. Do you know what I'm saying? So what they did in the past before I got here is they would make this come out when they made that purchase to come out to perfectly $13,250 and they would take the other $3,998 and throw it into general supplies. Mm-hmm. I don't want them to do that anymore. I want them to, if they want to do that, then do that. Put it, if they're devices, put it in devices. But then Pete knows he's got to adjust his other budget line to buy that $3,998 for that overage.
That was purchase of Chromebooks on our cart, and it was a decision we made that we needed so many and we bought them. The budget line item didn't meet, you know, didn't have quite that much money in it, but as Patty said, she wants us to just show that we've gone over on that.
Okay.
So he knows he's got to save that in another budget line item.
Okay. And then the salary of the custodial, is that the same as what's going on with the clerical?
Yes and no. We had some overtime because we had some, when we lost one custodian and lost the other custodian, our main custodian was working some overtime. So I'm hoping that we're going to have some savings in another payroll line in our IAs to balance that off.
Okay, because I thought I saw there was a deficit in IAs too. Maybe I didn't.
No, right now we have a $515 savings there. That's on page 2, Don, and it's number 2330. Function code 2330. It's about 3/4 of the way down the page. The IAs.
IAs.
Are we on the same report or are you?
I think he's on the other report.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm doing by function code.
You're doing it. He's doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so,
it's sort of the same.
I don't know. I don't understand how you get these two reports.
The four digits.
Oh, that's all right. No, it's not.
So those are. Yeah.
That's textbooks. 500.
You should be in the fives. So let me come over and I'll show you. So payroll accounts all have 5 as the second function code. So if you flip that over here, so see 5 is all payroll. So we're going to look for 5 and then 2330. which is right here, salary classroom assistants.
No, that's fine, but there was something else here.
General textbook?
General textbooks, he's over 478.
Is that another one like the devices?
Yes. So anything that's in Pete's expenses, he can overspend a budget line item, but then he knows he's got to save that in the other line items. Or what I can do is make a budget transfer.
Here's the one I'm talking about with the IAs. It's under the last page on this report, number four.
It's in the school choice fund, I think.
Does it start with the first three numbers, 003?
Yep.
Okay, so that's school choice, and we're balanced between the IAs and the sped IAs, we're off $23. So it's just a difference between who I budgeted for and who Pete assigned.
And that's like 500.
So you gotta take them in a lump?
She's using that 600 to offset that.
In the case of the Chromebooks as devices or hardware, do we have just a line item just for technology?
Yes.
We have a technology hardware line item, and we have a technology software line item. Okay. So on the hardware is the Chromebook one, and that's the one we're over on?
Yes, sir.
Because we didn't have enough money, and we...
We wanted so many Chromebooks, and we knew that it was gonna use the whole line item and then some.
Then some.
Yeah.
We just gonna have to...
But we bought based on what we needed, not so much with the line item.
Is it another one of those things, Rob, from Peter to give to Paul at the end, like, basically?
What is the life of a Chromebook? Do we have a plan for renewing them, or...
That's not a question that I really should answer, I'm not sure. I mean, I expect they last for several years, you know.
Right, so there's not a schedule already in place for replacing them?
I would say the budget line item is a healthy line item that will continue to go forward.
You might not need all that much every year.
Correct.
Absolutely right.
So it's kind of an exception.
We're trying to outfit by grade level.
We will, yeah.
The driver for it this year is the MCAS 2.
It's gonna be...
And we're going to do the MCAS 2 on the computers. We're gonna do the computerized test next year, or we'll be required to do it. We're doing it this year because we wanna try it. But that's the driver behind buying the Chromebooks.
And what we've been doing is trying to do it by grade level. So that's when Pete's saying he wanted a certain number, we wanted to do the fourth grade or the fifth grade. Correct?
Yeah, well, we have 40. And we bought them so that they could be used by at least two classes at a time. People sign them out, take four or five at a time. They've been extremely useful and helpful. And yes, when testing time rolls around, then it's sounding like we're gonna test in the classrooms. Kids can stay at their own desks, have a Chromebook in front of them, rather than come here and sit at a...
Is this where you usually have the testing in here instead, if it was written?
No, if it's paper tests, they're in their classroom, which is why we wanna stay in the classroom, rather than have them come in here to do their MCAS on these computers, more familiar settings.
But if they don't have a chance to interact with the Chromebooks, it'll all be new at testing time. So the idea is to get them in the kids' hands.
Chromebooks get a lot of use, and they're housed in this upper wing, but they're used in the lower wings, too. People do use them quite...
So next year, you won't buy 40 Chromebooks?
No, we won't. We may buy another 10 or 15, but we won't buy 40 again.
So is there a line that you can delay buying something this year to offset that?
Yeah.
Is that what the plan would be?
Mm-hmm.
So you have a place that you thought about that?
I don't have one particular line item, but I keep my eye on everything that we have. I don't believe we've ever gone over budget entirely. In my 8 years, we've always had a surplus in the budget here.
Or to turn the heat down a couple degrees and put a sweater on.
Okay.
Right. Put more wood in the fire.
Well, and so for an example, I will show you, if you, and Don, you've got a different report, but if we look at the Nature's Classroom line item, we have $1,275 left there. Nature's Classroom's over. We've paid everything we have to with Nature's Classroom, and we still have $1,200. So that'll be one, that's an offset for him against the overspending on the Chromebooks.
Just want you to know I'm looking.
I want you to look.
That's great. So I noticed that you encumber the salaries, but you don't seem to encumber the other expenses as much as regularly? Is there a reason for that? Or you don't at all?
So with the towns, it's different than the Frontier. So we process the payroll and we process the AP, but the town has the money. So they're actually doing the paying.
Okay.
So I manually encumber salaries. I have a huge spreadsheet that I update every paycheck for 26 pays for the elementary by person. Uh-huh. And then I project what we owe till the end of the year. Uh-huh. And then I manually make a journal entry every month to encumber that.
Yep.
On the expenditure side, up until I think 2 years ago when Scott got here, we did not have the capacity to share the software with the schools. Mm-hmm. So all the purchase orders for the non-payroll things, they do manually here by purchase orders. So the only time we get them is when we get a bill.
Okay.
So we're trying to change that now. And we finally, I have someone trained, and they're going to start going out and training. And Conway in January is going to be the first school that's going to start doing their purchase orders online.
Okay.
Once they're rocking and rolling, Whately is my next target. So I'm hoping by the end of June, I'm going to have the two smaller elementary schools online so that when Pete's purchasing, it's going to be live now. He's not going to have to handle, like, so
they
it's
have
like
a shadow budget here, though.
Exactly. And he manually keeps it, and I try to manually keep it, and it's a lot of manual work. So they'll start, hopefully, I'm hoping by the end of, the beginning of May, that they'll start entering purchasing recs. So we'll then see that, you know, he's already spent $15,000. Right. He's got another PO for $1,000, so we'll know. And when Mary goes to put in another purchase order, if there's not enough money in that budget line, it's going to stop her. It's not going to let her issue that PO. Okay. So we'll have a lot more lifetime reporting and a lot more budget control.
Okay. And that will be helpful for us to see a little more.
Right. And then and when we get to that point, what I'll be bringing to you every month is probably a vote for to transfer money. So if Pete then decides he wants to take $1,200 out of the Nature's Classroom and put it to the devices, I'd be bringing you, here's the budget transfers Pete is proposing. And then we'll actually fix the budget line, so then come budget time, we know where we need money and we know where we, you know, where we don't need money, what budget lines we can increase and which ones we can decrease. Okay. So that is our goal.
Okay. Thank you.
Do you have more for your report, or are you done?
No, I was just going to say you had the six warrants to sign, and I was going to give the total $53,308.78. Katie, did you want to look at those? Because Don and Bob signed them.
That's okay.
Okay.
She trusts us.
I do.
She trusts us.
I trust you.
And do you want me to resend these to you?
No, I looked in my email. I'll look again. I thought I couldn't find them, but maybe they are there. Everyone else got them.
Well, it was. Did you get the memo of the bus safety procedures?
No.
I got that.
That was in the same email.
Oh, so maybe it's in my spam or something. If you don't mind resending it,
I will resend it.
Thank you.
Okay. Public comment. No public comment. All right. Unfinished business. Update on the cafeteria. Who wants to take that?
Do you want to jump into the survey?
Yeah.
Is that what you'd like to do? Sure. Okay, so Lynn asked me to put together a survey for our community on the lunch program, and then Patty was kind enough to send me a couple of other surveys that she had that we combined into the survey that's in front of you. Not in front of you. It will be up on board in a minute. And I am also going to give you, so we just did the survey last week, and we have about 45 or so respondents. And rather than try to give you paper tonight, I am going to give you the login name and the password so that you can go to SurveyMonkey and spend some time on the survey. But I'll show you what we have for now.
I did go to SurveyMonkey to look at the 10 questions.
Oh, good.
And I think I answered them correctly, so.
So let me just wake up this machine here.
I heard you surveyed the kids, too.
Well, the kids did a scatter survey, just a very basic. We took all the meals for the month, right up to this double line. Those are the primary things that we serve. I probably should not have put salad bar on here because while a lot of kids access it, most don't think of it as a main meal. So the two dots I don't think indicates
the popularity of a salad bar. I think it's much more popular. But those are pretty much the meals you see month to month.
Boy, chicken noodle really hit it out of the park, didn't it?
Chicken noodle soup, and this is the soup. So we gave the kids two stickers each. They only took the soup sticker if they're kids who said, yeah, I get soup a lot. And then they went ahead and put a sticker up. Now, of course, we caution the kids about not putting a sticker just because your friend put it there or because it looks popular, but, you know, kids will be kids. But I think that, generally speaking, it's fairly accurate because I can tell you that the kitchen staff told me which ones would be most popular, and they were absolutely right. So the flatbread pizza is a big hit, as you can see. And then these can be compared to the parent survey, keeping in mind that what the kids think is best isn't always what the parents allow them to get. So those could be two different things. All right, I'm going to sit down here, and there's... We have some families that don't like to use, you know, digital, so we did hand out probably 10 or so families like paper, so I have another 4 or 5 paper surveys over there. So that would come up to about 50 surveys, which is not terrible for, you know, for percentage of response, by the way. So I'm just going to go through this knowing that you're going to be able to get to it later. So the first one is just the volume per day. Right, when it first went out on the 29th, we had our most responses. We did send out reminders. And then, of course, the responses have trickled off as we've gone through here. But let me go to analyze results. I think that's the tab I want to look at to show you some of the... Okay. Also, I did not leave a box for staff in this first one. Again, I'm not a survey guy. I put it together pretty quickly. But so there was no box to say, you know, if you're a staff member. So these are parents saying what grade their kids are in. Okay. So most of the respondents came from 6th grade, as you can see, followed by 4th and 2nd, and so on. Just to give you an idea of who responded. And there it is in number form rather than the graph. On a weekly average, how often do your children buy lunch at school? Most of our customers use the lunch program 4 or more times a week, if the sample is accurate. And by the way, also, you know, one of the things I do know about statistics and surveys is that you're more likely to get unsatisfied people filling out your survey. Satisfied folks might not bother. But what's interesting, you'll see this in the survey, is that even folks who had some significant critiques in specific areas checked off that they're very satisfied or satisfied. But you'll see that in just a moment. So that's rather telling there, that the people who buy lunch are pretty loyal to it and do it often. What are your child's favorite food selections that we offer? And by the way, you'll see this yourself when you look at this yourself. Some of these won't work for you because that's the premium program, and this is the free SurveyMonkey. but if you pay a little, and I think Louise has I think the central office has a SurveyMonkey that's a paid subscription, so you can get more text, more analysis and stuff. But again, just out of the box here for this will certainly be helpful for you. So in this category, you know, we'd have to scroll down, but this is each person's response at answering the question of what's your child's favorite food. Salad, soup, chicken patty, spaghetti, chicken burgers. You know, so people could name more than one, obviously, because this was comment box, not forced choice. So if you scroll through that on your own time, you'll see what the more popular meals are, and you'll see that they do correspond quite a bit with what the kids say. The other next question was, what are some possible reasons for why your child does not purchase lunch at all or on certain days? And this one, as you can see, the answer that is predominantly checked off is the quality of the food, and followed by the nutritional value of the food, and not enough options.
What's the top one, Pete? That one's pretty high.
Oh, that's the other one. Lunches are too expensive. Here, let me go to the where it's spelled out. Lunches are too expensive. So in order, quality of the food, followed by expense.
No, nutrition, then expense.
Patty, you're right. Nutritional value, then expense.
And that's why they don't purchase.
These are reasons why they may not either purchase at all or, again, the survey isn't designed to capture every discrete thing. So these are answers from people who are saying, we maybe only do it once a week because of these reasons. And there may be some parents who don't buy it at all.
But that's somewhat encouraging that expensive wasn't the top.
Correct.
Because you could pick more than one.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, expensiveness was the third category. What suggestions do you have for improving student participation in the lunch program? And again, this is where folks were able to put comments, and they are also telling in many ways. People, the pancakes came up a lot, breakfast and lunch came up a lot. They want more kid-friendly choices, people want to see more fresh fruits, more fresh vegetables. But again, I'll, rather than, you know, I haven't analyzed them further and written everything down, so rather than me trying to tell you what I think I saw, you'll be able to see for yourself. More and more folks like, talked about this, like, can we get local food from local farms? And we do some of that.
Most of our fruits come from, and vegetables come from the farmers.
Some people chose to ride a little more than others, and, but again, you'll get a chance to take a look at that yourself. This is also interesting to me, that we, you know, the vast majority of respondents fall into the first three categories, either neutral, satisfied, or very satisfied. I guess if you do the numbers and add up satisfied and very satisfied, it's 39.
We got to take care of that one person.
A little under 40%, yeah.
It does bother me that they're the majority is neutral.
Yeah, that is neutral. That is bothersome.
That's not, yeah,
but
that's
also keep in mind that one person represents almost 2.5% on this survey because it's a small number. So it's just important to keep that in mind too. What healthy foods would you suggest that are not currently offered? Again, we got some great, you know, great feedback here. More vegetarian options. You know, not necessarily the healthiest things, some of them, but certainly things that kids like and they want to eat, like chicken wings. But you will see a lot of real healthy options here. And then some are things that maybe we used to do or previously had in our school, like shepherd's pie, but we don't see that on the menu anymore, so parents maybe want that back. They like chicken that's baked here, cooked here, rather than, you know, frozen and brought in, as opposed to that. But again, lots of, you know, we got a lot. The people who did respond took time to answer some questions and did so, I think, very, very well. So it gives us a good idea of where we're headed. Are there any simple steps that we could take to make it more likely that your child would eat certain foods, such as cutting up apples, fresh vegetables, etc.? And again, you'll see that some of the responses are right on the money. Fresh is better. You know, let's cut up the apples. Instead of giving them a whole apple, there's a better chance they'll eat more of it. And again, these are all things that if we discussed it with the kitchen staff, we would get answers like, we're happy to do that, it does take more time, you know, it's going to be one more thing we have to do before the kids are in the lunchroom. You'll see answers like, and I'm just sort of trying to present a little bit of both sides here. I would like to see the food made in a way that kids can just get apple slices and eat them and not take two bites and then throw out three quarters of the apple. But even questions that got answers like, kids feel like they don't have enough time to eat, for example. By the time they get their food and sit down, they don't have a lot of time. Well, we recognize that, and we know that it's hard. And quite frankly, on days when it's a popular lunch, now you don't increase the staff when it's a popular lunch, so now two people have to serve a lot more kids. One of the things that we do to try to make that work is if we know that it's going to be a popular lunch, then I try to make sure that we can get everybody in here as early as possible. And also, what the staff in the wings have done, at least the upper wing, is that they take turns on which class goes into the cafeteria first. Right? So in other words, just out of fairness, you know, if fifth grade goes in first today, then it's sixth tomorrow, then it's fourth the next day, so they get in line first, and you know, just one of the things we try to do. The only other way to fix that, if we increase the lunch block, we probably have to decrease the recess block a little bit. Teachers would have my head if I suggested decreasing instructional time, so we're not going to do that. But it's a balance. We have 50 minutes for that block, and we try to give the kids 25 minutes, 20 to 25 minutes for lunch. And for some kids,
enough? You think 20, 25 minutes is enough?
I think if it was longer, more kids would do better. But we also have probably half the kids in there finish in 20 minutes. But, you know, some kids, everybody's different, you know.
From a nutritional point, one of the things they tell us is that it takes 20 minutes for your stomach to signal the brain that it's full. And yet we're telling kids to eat the whole meal in 20 minutes. So their stomachs never have time to tell their brain they're full. And that could be one of the causes of the epidemic child obesity, because the children just eat what's on their plate without waiting to have their stomach signal the brain that they are full.
One of the things you'll notice when you, go ahead, Don.
The people that are monitoring the lunchroom, are they the same ones monitoring the recess?
Yes.
Okay, because one of the thoughts I had was perhaps you know, the kids that are slower can stay behind, finish their meals, and then go out to recess.
No, we do recess first. So at the end of lunch, it's time to go to class. And sometimes kids stay behind, but, you know, to finish up. But again, you know, we hear from the teachers if kids come back to class a little late, you know, and it's okay. I mean, I'm not complaining. Teachers have their priority. They want to get kids in the, back in their rooms so they can get busy with instruction.
But food, I think
but
food
we also
is,
want them to have enough time to eat.
I think food is, well, I'm not going to say it's more important than learning something, but I think food is important. And
sometimes it takes time for them to get through the line. So, like, I come for lunch here, and I stand, and I wait till all the kids go through, and you can be in that line for about 8 to 10 minutes, and then they sit down, but they're also busy talking and socializing because it's free time, and so there's a lot of that. One of the great things that Whately does is the children get different color sticks every day.
They sit at tables?
Yep, so they sit, there's no exclusion at all. They sit at a color table depending on the stick they get, which is fantastic. So the fourth graders are sitting with fifth and sixth, so they're not cliques, they're not all sitting together. But
is that Mr. Skrosky's invention?
I think that's a Skrosky idea.
Was that your, that is the best thing, in 25 years in education, that's the best thing I ever saw. But there is still...
Wow, it tastes much of a pressure.
Well, no, it is. Lunch can be very hard on kids, yeah. Don't kid yourself.
Socially, yes.
Yeah, but there's a lot of talking and a lot of laughing and...
Yeah, it is definitely a social time for kids. I don't
think, my kids say they
you know,
talk
when they're in line,
I don't
think...
They don't eat, yeah.
I don't think that their, you know, their socialization in line isn't necessarily what's slowing things down. I mean, I think you do get a couple of kids that sometimes take a little longer to decide, oh, I'm having
We're talking about as they're sitting.
Yeah, when they're sitting.
They're spending a lot of time talking.
Yeah, they talk, and then they're not eating necessarily. Yeah. And our staff definitely goes around, and we know who those kids are, and we say, hey, come on, get focused, you got to eat. One of the things I do want you to look at is that I think in this particular question here, you'll see a lot of answers that match up, that people want fresh fruit, people want fresh veggies, they don't want it to come out of a big can. A lot more people are starting to understand that, you know, there is a movement all across the country that says, you know, drink whole milk. Don't just take the egg white out. You need, it's healthier for you. That's the reason nature made it all one big thing, is because the fat in the milk serves a purpose too. But unfortunately, some of the things that parents want, state won't let you have. I mean, I don't think we can have whole milk according to the state. But people are interested in whole milk more than they
drink
ever
whole milk
have
now.
Milk.
Yeah. I don't drink 1%. I drink whole milk. As little milk I drink, I want it to be the best of my cereal.
Right.
And then, of course, the chocolate milk is not only low fat, but it's high sugar.
Right.
And some parents recognize that, and they just won't buy it.
And I think one of the other conundrums we're seeing here is everybody wants fresh, 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 but fresh costs more. But they're complaining that our cost is too high. So there's no way we could introduce all this freshness and not increase our prices.
Well, fresh costs more and sometimes has a little more labor intensity. But
that's what it is. I don't think fresh costs more as much, but it's the labor involved. So if we
the cutting up of the apple.
Yeah, or the peeling of the carrots or the slicing of the celery sticks. And kids love those celery sticks.
So then question 9 was a rather general question again about, do you have any suggestions or feedback on the current payment system, how it works, how we can improve it? And again, you'll see the ability to know your balance maybe in real time online, online payments. Some people feel like the payment system now is fine. Like to be able to get my child's running balance again. So you'll see electronic billing and payments. You know, card swipe comes up in here. Scan card option. So folks, you know, the people who responded know what's available elsewhere, and would like to see that. And then of course the last question is, what would you like to see eliminated from the menu? And that's also very, very telling. And even things that are popular. Let's not do it every week, some people are saying. You know, let's do it less, maybe twice a month.
I never heard of pancakes in the bag.
Oh, they got one here.
Can you tell me what that is?
They're frozen pancakes, and they come in a bag, and we steam them.
For some parents, the problem is they're steamed in the bag, and in most cases, you know, putting plastic in a microwave or...
It's not good.
I'm not sure if steaming does the same thing where stuff comes out of the plastic. I'm not really sure. But, you know, that's why parents, I think, are wary of it, because these days, you know, everything we know about plastic and things like that. Some people are like, there's no way you're eating those pancakes that were in that bag. So anyway, that's the survey that we, well, thanks to Patty for the information she gave.
Yeah, that's helpful.
What I did bring you tonight is, I'll turn this off in just a minute, but just to help you along, this is the address and the password and the username. Keep it to yourself, please, because we will do more surveys probably on this account. Here you go. That'll get you in so you can look at it on your free time.
I lost my earrings. I lost an earring, so if anybody sees an earring, it's mine.
And I'll try to answer your questions if you'd like, but you know, some of them may be better answered by the folks who run the program, but I'm happy to try.
That was great, Pete. Thank you.
I know what soups not to have here anymore.
No, some of those are really excellent. It's just the kids only got one. Keep in mind, the kids only got one sticker, so they had to choose one. If they were told to choose their top three, that chart would look different.
I love every one of those soups.
Oh, the butternut bisque. My wife makes butternut bisque. I mean, it's great. But you know, how can you beat chicken noodle? That's, or corn chowder. I think I saw corn chowder.
They're awful. They're so good.
And then, you're also going to see responses that are inaccurate. I mean, one person, I think, wrote, how about trying something like homemade soups? I mean, that's one of our more popular things, but there's a parent out there who doesn't know that, unfortunately. Soups are all from scratch. Yeah. But that might speak to the marketing end of things. You know, if parents don't know about it, then maybe we're not doing our job marketing it, well enough.
Any other comments about the cafeteria for now? Great job. Okay, thanks, Pete.
Thank you.
Update on the tree damage. We talked about it last month, I believe.
The letter, I think.
Have we heard any?
I gave my notes. I actually shared my notes with, but here it is. This is a letter from Brian Domina. Dear Dr. Carey, thank you for your letter of October 7th informing the Select Board of the request from the Whately School Committee to consider purchasing the land adjacent to the Whately Elementary School building. The Select Board supported the idea of purchasing the land and obtained an appraisal to determine the value of the land. Unfortunately, the Select Board and the property owner were unable to agree on the purchase of the land. Therefore, the town and the district should move forward with plans to reestablish the vegetative screening on the land currently owned by the town. These events do not preclude the possibility of a purchase of the land by the town at a future date. So we were not able to, the town was not able to purchase that land.
Do you know what it was assessed for? Does anybody know what it was assessed for?
We were at the meetings.
Well, they didn't know at the time what the assessed value was.
Like
it was, wasn't it?
$1,500 or something.
I think they'd be in tax on $900.
I thought it was closer to $15.
That land is in APR, and the value of the land, based on the APR, is considered agricultural.
What does APR mean?
I don't know what the acronym is, but it's money, it's a fund that the town and the state apply to purchase the rights to agricultural land so that it stays agricultural, can't be developed. So they actually pay the owner to give up the rights on using that as a commercial or industrial area. And I think the APR in Whately is somewhere around $10,000 an acre. So if you were to put that in that 8/10, you're looking at a price around there. So I think that's probably where the hang up is. But in the future, if that land is to be sold, then Whately, the school would have first option on that. The town has the first option on APR land.
Excuse me.
We have another look at it.
So let's figure out the tree situation then. And
so I think that in the spring that we need to be in touch with Keith and talk to the town if he's going to do it or who's going to remove the stumps and do the, get the planting started. So I don't know who follows up on that.
Well, I certainly can. When we talk spring, we're talking February or March?
I would say start early so it reminds people that...
I think we should send a letter to Keith now saying that they were unable to purchase, so please start planning that in the spring we'll be finishing the vegetation, the removal and the, of the old vegetation and the replacement of the new.
We should probably find out from the insurance company how much money that they're talking about that they're going to give us to plan, so we know a dollar figure ahead of time that the insurance company is giving us for the...
Well, I think Keith's going to have to do that because he's going to have to figure out what he's going to put in there.
Right. But if we, at least if we know ahead of time, I don't want to come in at $1,000, but we got $5,000.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is if Keith gets the pricing, submits it to the insurance company.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, I think we'll have to probably work with the selectmen as well because I think they sign off on this because it's, you know, town insurance.
It's the town insurance.
Right.
So I think he needs to touch base with the selectmen and the school committee to keep everybody in the loop.
Right.
So just thinking ahead, if we go ahead this spring and pull, you know, remove whatever needs to be removed, replant, worst case scenario is if the town does get that land later and it somehow gets allocated as land that we can use for the school, not too terrible. It just means that our barrier is going to be on this side of land that we may use for something else, whatever that might be when the time comes.
Did you have an idea what you would want to put in? I know Keith has gotten an idea, but as a hedgerow there or something, I mean, have you got your own ideas being...
Oh, in terms of what they want to plant?
Yeah.
No, I didn't. I mean, I know that he brought in an arborist too, who made a suggestion about a particular type of pine that would grow quickly and create, you know, a good barrier, so that's definitely not my field of expertise. I thought you meant like what might happen with it. I know that people are talking about added parking, which, you know...
I didn't know if you had your...
It's reasonable.
I know what arborvitae's do. Arborvitae's are tight.
They talked about using some...
You know, they're nice and tight. You know, they grow tight, they give you, I think, the best barrier versus a regular certain type of pine tree that he's talking about where a lot of stuff can go through it versus an arborvitae that's tight knit and stuff like that won't die down below, that will prevent anything bad from the fields that may come this way, possibly.
All right, so we'll keep that on the back burner until the spring. All right, update on the Green Community Grant.
That's going to be Bob.
Bob.
Basically, going back to the very beginning, we knew there was about $130,000 in there. We had a study, the town had a study done by Bales. He recommended several projects. We found the one that seemed to be the best fit with the best payback, which was the energy management system. That was projected in the Bales study to be in excess of the money we had. We bid it with some options. The price on that came in very good. It came in at just under $74,000. So we've added 4,800 and change orders to that, bringing the total of that project up to 78,580. That project has been ongoing. It's been, I don't think we've had any disruption in the school or anything with it. I think they're pretty close to being done. I saw one invoice. I'm not sure what percentage they had billed, but they'll easily finish that for the end of the year. After that, we made a decision to try to find something to spend the remaining money. We looked at a lighting project and we looked at motors and drives on the air handlers. And the motors and drives were a little bit more expensive and didn't have quite the payback and were kind of a complex project. So we zeroed in on the LED lighting. We had an initial bid of that of about $58,000, and that had a payback yearly of about $4,000 a year, actually $43,34. That was a little bit over budget, so we talked with the vendor and made an agreement for him to eliminate overtime and work in the school here around the students. Pete was okay with that. Then the project actually came in a little bit too low, So we added a little back in for shelf stock, and we ended up with a project of $54,425, which matches the Green Communities money just exactly where it ought to. At this point, the vendor has the material and is ready to start. Actually, he was going to start last Thursday. I'm waiting for Brian. Brian needs to work through a formality with DOER to get approval from them. As soon as we hear that he has approval, we'll start that job. Barring some unforeseen issue with getting started, the contractor assures me he can easily finish that and have it built out for the end of the year.
Sounds good.
My end of that project is to try to minimize the, by the way, what Bob said about the controls project is absolutely correct. There's been no impact. I mean, besides the fact that the hatch is open and there's a ladder up, you wouldn't know they were even here doing the work, which is great. I don't think that's going to be the case with the LED lighting. We're probably going to have anywhere from a half day, maybe a little longer, where they can get into a classroom. It's the only way to eliminate the overtime, right? To bring the project down was to have them work during the day. So I've already put out a message to my staff letting them know that they may be displaced on a particular day. What I don't want to do is surprise them with what day. So whoever the manager of that project is needs to work carefully and closely with me and Andy so that we can, A, have them, if they can start early, I don't know what their start time is, but if they can start early before any kids are here, and you know, do classrooms in the morning, but while it's not much of a disruption, but if they have to get into classrooms during the day, I want at least a day notice so that we can move the class into the library media center, or the teacher can make their own decisions about what we're going to do today and how we're going to spend our day until we can get back into our classroom. So that'll require some coordination so that we can do both successfully.
Is there on the lighting, is there different types of LED lighting?
Yes, there are. The particular the lamps that we're using, they've found, you know, they've done a whole bunch of different retrofits over the years for LED lighting, and they found the one that works out the best is to take the ballasts out of the fixtures, but use a LED lamp that actually fits in the same socket as the lamp that's there.
Yeah.
So they're very easy to replace if there's any issues later. My guess is we won't see any of the lamp. You know, these lamps will last a lot longer than what we had previously. And we're buying all 5,000 Kelvin lamps, which are very close to daylight, which is an issue.
I guess that's my question. Is it good for the eyes?
Yes.
Is it, you know, good for everybody to read?
The contractor that's doing this is Universal Electric. They've done a ton. They've been a preferred contractor for the electrical utility. Because they have that designation, they can, DOER is lets them bid the project. They can do the project without our getting bids on it. And they've done work in the high school. They've done work at Conway. They've done work. They did the parking lot lighting here and some lighting. They've been very good people to work with. So I'm optimistic that this will be a good project.
Thanks, Bob. Any other questions? Okay, moving along. Bus driver training procedures.
So I gave you all a memo, and unfortunately Katie didn't get it.
I did get it. I remember seeing this.
Okay. So what is outlined, Mass General Law oversees the school bus driver training programs and also the instructor programs. And since June of 2010, all bus drivers are required to receive 60 hours of instructional training in order to get their license. And after that, to recertify annually, they have to get 8 additional hours. Those 8 additional hours are provided to our drivers by GRIPCO LLC, who is our transportation. They have 2 certified trainers on staff and provide the 8 hours that are required for relicensure. In addition to that, the school district, we ourselves, at the beginning of every school year, we meet with the bus drivers and we provide them with the updates on the anti-bullying curriculum, and also our nurse, our leader, gives them some medical emergency training, EpiPens, things like that. For the first time this Friday, the Mass State Police are going to be meeting with our drivers and presenting school bus security. Presentation that'll happen at Frontier Regional this Friday at 9 o'clock. And then I sent to you what the requirements are on transporting passengers, their pre-trip inspections, loading and trip starts, so for you to review. And I think that our company does a very good job where our safeties, the student safety is concerned. And I think that they're doing everything we can, and I know Dr. Carey is going to address in her minutes, in her notes, some things that we can do, that we're looking into for what we can do.
Thank you. I do think the safety's in good shape. I'm curious if you could tell me more about the contract, how they're managed?
How our bus contract is?
Yeah, because it is one of the biggest expenses besides salary.
So we have, since I arrived here in the district, we have gone out to bid with other Franklin County school districts. So we do a collaborative bid, and it goes out in two ways. All of us together, and then each one individually.
Okay.
So here in Whately, in our district of our four towns, we have a small bus company, Gribco, and one other town, I believe it's up in Orange, has a small transportation company. Because Meskis has everyone else.
Okay.
So the last time, I believe this is our third year of a five-year contract. No, next year is the third year. This is the second. It's either the second or the third. I'd have to check, Katie. I'm sorry. So when we looked at the bid between Meskis and Gribco, Gribco was significantly less.
Uh-huh.
So that is what we do. We have to go out by law,
yeah.
30B, for our contractor, and we went out collaboratively with all the other school districts in Franklin County,
mm-hmm.
And Gribco still comes in the lowest bidder.
So is the portion, Whately pays a portion of the bill, or
nope.
How is it?
Each school of the five have their own contract with Gribco.
Uh-huh.
With the number of bus routes that each individual town has and Frontier.
So it's based on the routes? I guess one thing I'm thinking is we have more and more school choice children who don't take the bus?
Correct.
So,
but we do allow, the school committee voted that if a parent brings their child to an existing stop,
uh-huh.
we do transport them.
Uh-huh.
We don't get, only the regionals right now get any form of reimbursement for transportation. Okay, so we're not getting any reimbursement from the state, so by you making that decision, the school committee making the decision to do the school choice, it doesn't have any impact because our buses are not full.
Right.
And
I guess that's what I'm thinking is just, are we maximizing the service that we're getting
no.
for that money?
But we have no other choices.
You can't have a kid on a bus for, like they do at Franklin Tech, for an hour.
No, I know.
You know, stuff like, I mean, if you try to use one bus to do
right.
two routes, and that's
no,
what...
No, I think there are reasons that people don't take the bus, and I'm wondering, more of a service marketing thing than... The safety, I think, is in good shape, and I just think the more we monitor and the more we know about how the buses are doing, maybe we could make better use of the buses. But it's not a big deal. It's just something that I've been thinking about.
Mm-hmm. And I've recently purchased a software to help us track, because I do think that we do spend too much money for transportation
it's
for the
of
amount
money,
of children.
I don't think
we,
a lot of children take the bus,
no.
and it's unfortunate that we have to spend. Like, I'm happy to spend it if people are using it.
Well, we don't have a choice.
And we have to spend it.
We have to spend it. But how we put our bid out is it, we, if we can narrow down our bid about what types of buses we want, we can do that the next time. So that might lower
that
the cost. But then if we get a flood of, but if I plan on, based on the number of riders we have now, and now everybody wants to ride, now we're in big trouble.
Right. That's all right.
So it's, you know, because I've had parents choose not to ride the bus because of the bus driver,
mm-hmm.
And it's just personality.
Mm-hmm.
I can't address that. I mean, right now it's very difficult to manage the transportation in this district because we're basically getting door-to-door service.
Yeah,
that's pretty luxurious.
Yeah. And I'm not sure people know that.
They don't understand.
No, I don't think they totally appreciate that, mm-hmm. which I guess my point is that...
I would walk a mile to school or whatever.
Okay, Abraham.
And similarly with school lunch, I don't think people really appreciate the nice school lunch that's here. in some ways, and I don't know how you fix that, but.
And I don't either, because to me, this is a very strange problem. I spend a lot of time on parental complaints about the school bus.
Right, and I imagine you do, and I'm trying to think of how do we alleviate you from having to be in, dealing with all of that too, but. I don't have an answer.
So I did, just like I said, I just recently went and got trained on this software so that I can at least locate and get better information about our children that are taking the bus. Where, and I'll be able to assist Gribco in routing the buses, because that's another thing I feel I don't have any control over, because I don't know the, I don't know the roads, and for, this is my fifth year here, Katie, and honest to God, I've yet to find a map with all the roads in any of the four towns. I've been everywhere.
A printed map.
A printed map. Mm-hmm. So it's hard for me. I have to go out and navigate, and I do all the time. I go for rides all the time. When a parent has a complaint about where we pick up and drop off, I go out and do a safety check. And then I bring Mr. Gribco with me, and we go out together, and I show him what, how I feel, and he tells me how he feels, because we're trying to, we're dealing with a 75-passenger bus on some roads that are paved.
Well, maybe it's about setting expectations properly up front as to what the parents can expect or what they should be focusing on.
And I think, and then that's what Dr. Carey is going to talk about. I think it's more about what our parents should expect and how our students should ride a bus. And we'll be looking at that.
Thank you.
Katie, I can tell you that from my perspective, because the complaints usually come to me first, and then I pass them on to Patty and the superintendent. And really, in the past year and a half, maybe a little bit longer, it's been a lot better.
Yeah, it does sound like you're being a lot more responsive.
Both our drivers right now are very good. One of them is newer than the other. But, you know, they certainly report concerns to me. I know that one of them, at least, and the other is newer, so maybe it's just a function of being new, but one of them talks to parents at stops, makes connections, shares information, asks them to talk to the kids if the kid is troublesome or if there's something going on. And it's really, I can't tell. I mean, I get notes from the bus driver every now and then about students, but it has been a while since I've had a parent concern, knock on wood. And I do think that sometimes that's a function of who the driver might be and how friendly they might be, or
it's,
you know,
a hard
whatever
job. It is, recognize that.
And nationwide, this is like where I can understand Mr. Gribco's point of view. We can't find bus drivers.
Right.
We can't find custodians, and we can't find bus drivers. No one wants these jobs. So it's hard when you have, you know, and Pete's correct. Whately is my least amount of time that I spend. But then I'll have parents say, the bus driver's not friendly enough. The bus driver's too friendly. They're human beings. I can't adjust the dial and make them just the right amount of friendly for you.
So I appreciate all the updates. It's helpful to understand how we think about it and all that you do to manage it.
Okay. Do you want to add anything, Glenn?
No, I will just say it's true. I actually had a parent say the bus driver doesn't say hello to my child. And so I did. I got on the bus and I said, please.
But they might be the first ones to complain if the poor, you know, the poor guy hands out candy as they
No candy on the bus.
No candy on the bus. And no dog biscuits either, so. Because we're handing out
dogs
for the
dogs. All right, well, thank you for the report. And we're on to new business. Analysis of the full day preschool. And I see we have our preschool coordinator here with us this evening, Kim McCarthy.
Hi, everyone.
So I don't know who wants to start this presentation, but I'm looking forward to it.
Oh, that's great. I'd be happy to, if that's okay with the team here. I'm hoping that you got this handout. It's the green, and I was I watched your last school committee, and I was thrilled to hear the interest on the expansion of the full day preschool. And it's something that, of course, my heart is so invested in, and it's really a pleasure for me to be here with you tonight. And I want to share kind of a historical perspective with you. So that's what that green box is. It shows the current year, and then this is the start of my third year. So that's where we are now, and I started back in 2014. And then I brought the data back to 2012 when we had a full day program. So it can kind of tell you the number of students, how many are residents from Whately, how many are residents from our district towns, and then if we have any kids that come from our further neighboring towns there. And below that is a tuition breakdown. We just went up to $240 a month. We did that after I attended a state conference, and we were markedly under the state mark for that. So we just went up last year, and we're kind of in the ballpark. There is still a range, and we're at the lower end of the range. We're a four-day program, Monday through Fridays, half day. And right now we have 12 kids in our program. Last year we had 10, the year before 10, and you'll see it that way. So the last box there is the number of little preschoolers that are in another program within our district. So it would be a Whately Town resident coming over to Deerfield to come to our preschool in Deerfield. That's the primary one. We have, it can vary year to year, but they primarily go to the full day preschool program in Deerfield. So that's kind of a historical look. That year that you did it in 2012, there were 17 kids in the program. You had 8 half day, 7 from Whately and 1 from Sunderland. You had 9 full day, and you were pulling in 5 from Deerfield, 1 from Conley, 1 from Sunderland, 1 from Greenfield, and 1 from Berniston. So that was your makeup back in that day, kind of thing. So the proposal under this is, before I get to that, Rhonda was so wonderful to help me survey our existing parents and then the parents, Whately residents that go to our other districts, and all of them were like 100%, we would love to see a full day program in Whately. And that was very, very overwhelmingly so. And you know, you hit on so many of the high points in your last meeting about the quality, which is of course where I come, but also the convenience for family and building the sense of community, a bridge from the child's first experience here. So the next notes that come are from my mind, right? It's these are the suggestions, and I'm thinking for next year we would shoot to have 15 to 16 kids come here, and that would be nice, and that Chrissy would be our full day teacher. This is wonderful, Chrissy Huntley. I'm sure you all know her, but she is a rock star, and how wonderful would it be to have you do that? So that would be really great. Our current rate for our full day is $38.50. That's what we charge in Deerfield. That's what we'll keep for next year because we just went up, and that's our new program in Sunderland. Will start 2 full day classrooms next year at $38.50 for that full time. We do offer for our families a sliding scale. Once you become full time, we can take vouchers to help families, and we also have something called a sibling discount if there were twins around. So that was my idea. I would limit it to 3 or 4 slots for half day students, but I would be open to working with this community if there was Whately parents that didn't want to shift a full day or that kind of thing. So we would really work with that. Because there's no such thing as school choice for preschool, I kind of defined what I'm thinking about who the population is. So Whately residents are the taxpayers in the town, and they would have the first slot, right? And they would be open for all those kinds of vouchers, sliding scales, you know, sibling discounts. And then, of course, the special education tuition reduction. Okay, so that would go for your town residents. And then the Frontier community would have openings for second slots, so we would advertise it that way. So folks from Conway, Deerfield, or Sunderland who needed a full day program, we'd like for them to come in. There'd be some discounts offered for these families. The problem with this, and I'll be real open, is when you're 3 and you're coming to us, you may or may not have a delay in your development, and it may or may not be noticed by your family or your pediatrician. I do a lot of talking with pediatricians in the area. It's just not noticed sometimes. So when we have our little 3-year-olds come to us, and Chrissy or your speech pathologist, Sally, finds a child that they're worried about with a disability, a developmental delay that would require special education services, that's when we get into trouble, when we have... And not trouble per se, but that's when we have to really, really be sensitive and caring about that student coming to our program and receiving services in their hometown. Because the town of Whately would not provide special education services for students that don't live in the town of Whately. Okay, so that is a challenge. I do go into families' homes, I go to playgroups locally, I try to build a good relationship with families coming in. We do a lot around parent education through my office, so that's one piece that can help us with that. But these are young kids, right? And a wide range of developmental norm in this age, so it's not so easy always to identify early on. That is our goal, though. And then the neighboring towns would be those towns like the Greenfield or the Montague, and we wouldn't have any tuition reduction for them. They would be our full pay kids, and we certainly have two in there now that are full pay for that. So thinking about the staff, you know, a nice conversation with Pete and with many people here around the table of thinking about shifting Chrissy's responsibilities so that she would become a full-day preschool teacher. She would wear two hats. She would be the regular elementary preschool hat, but she's also a special education teacher. She's duly certified for that. And she would keep some of her liaison duties. She now in the afternoon is a special education teacher for grades K through 3 to K through 2. So she keeps some of those, and that will all be determined as we go along. We certainly, Chrissy has the heart and the work ethic of I don't know, 100 wonderful angels, I guess. So we have to really make sure that we can look at that and plan for it very strategically for her. Right now, she has an IA that works in her classroom in the morning. We'd like that IA to continue in the afternoon. And more importantly, part of the whole package is to offer an extended care option to 5:30 for our working folks, for our folks that are going to UMass for school. So our program would really run 8:30 to 5:30. The day program, the 8:30 to 3, would be run as this typical school calendar that you would have for kindergarten through grade 6. And then we'd have an extended care program. We don't call it an out-of-school time, but it's really what it is. We call it an extended care program that we'd have to hire a staff for. And those are the suggestions down there.
And that would be kept in the preschool room?
Yes.
Versus the out-of-time, out-of-school program?
Yes. Regulations-wise, we can't mix.
Right.
And the other thing, too, is the quality. We can ensure a really high quality experience for these kids when they've been in school all day from they're 3 and they've been here since 8:30 in the morning, and we want to keep it fresh and going for them to really keep that healthy engagement. You know, we don't want meltdowns and lots of transitions for them, so we keep them in the environment. We only change one variable at a time, right? We'll get another staff member in there, but keep them in their familiar setting for that. They would have option for bag or hot lunch, and then out of the tuition for extended care, we would provide the snack. It can be a deal breaker for parents to have to pack 2 snacks during the day. I don't know. You remember that morning routine, right? So, oh my goodness, right? So the extended care would provide the snacks. We would charge a flat rate for that, $15 per kid in the afternoon, and the sliding scale would apply to Whately and possibly our frontier community residents, but it wouldn't apply for those broader neighboring towns. There is some startup costs. We have a lot of the mats already, but we would need a little bit more of the mats. There's probably a little bit in advertising, so we kind of put those things in there. There's a collaboration that we'd like to make with our Karen Green that does the family engagement activities and really make it a sense of community that really goes from birth onward through Frontier and that way. We also, with the increase, there'll be a little bit of money, funds coming from the tuition income to cover the protocols that we have and some of the staff for our screening. And we are, by regulations, to screen. That's the whole purpose of having a school-based preschool, to find kids early and give them the support they need so we can really help prevent bigger difficulties later. A big push in our district is really about prevention of maladaptive behavior challenging kids, right? And the associated anxiety, depression, withdrawal, those kinds of things. So we have a lot of plans in there in terms of family work with that piece. So that was some of my thoughts. You know, build a full day program, have it run 8:30 to 5:30, have Chrissy be in charge of it, 8:30 to 3, like a school day, provide that high-quality education with all the special education support services embedded in that. Build capacity for your extended care. The program would pay for itself, really, at a $15 flat rate. And if more kids come, then they're paying for the extra IAs that come in, that kind of thing. So that's what I presented to these wonderful brains over here. And then Patty took the numbers and did magic with them. So she's really got two other pages that may be new to you tonight that kind of were passed around. I didn't email this to you all. And if you don't have any questions for me about that, I'd maybe have Patty present and then we could wrap around, unless you have questions now.
I have a couple questions for you. Who would provide these extended care?
We have to hire an extended care coordinator. And what we've done in Deerfield now, and this is our second year and it's worked out really well, is that we have that person provide the IA duties in the afternoon so they get to know the children and the families and build the capacity if there is a plan for a child with special needs that needs to carry over in the afternoon, so they've really built that capacity. That money would come out of the tuition that we pull in. I pay $20 an hour for that extended care coordinator is what we call that person.
Okay, and you're talking about moving Chrissy to full-time.
Yeah.
And relieving some of her special ed duties. And I guess the question is for Pete, who's going to pick up the slack on the students that she's not going to see?
Right, so Chrissy's already full-time in the schedule because she's a special educator.
I understand that.
So what will happen is, you know, I suppose year to year we'll have to take a look at how many IEPs we have, because that's a variable, as you know. If Chris can keep some of the IEPs outside of her grade, that'll help the other special educator in our building, Terry Anderson. But Terry Anderson is aware of this plan and on board and prepared to have a larger caseload. You know, it's probably not going to change by more than 3-4 students maybe. But part of my plan, Don, too, is that right now Terry Anderson and Chris together have 1.5 IAs during, you know, full-time equivalents that support students in the special education world. And I've already discussed with Patty boosting that up to 2 IAs that are, you know, that will support Terry if she's sort of the primary special educator. So she'll have, you know, 2 people available, 2 IAs available to her instead of 1. And we can probably do that with current staffing because, you know, moving into next year, we're already discussing possible reductions in the IA staff because we have some classrooms where we have 2 adults right now because of some student needs. And I've discussed with Patty reducing that by 1 person, but holding on to the other person.
So you wouldn't be looking at hiring another person half a day?
We wouldn't be looking for another hire. We'd be doing it with our current staff.
And what's the maximum number of kids you can provide for in the program?
So it depends on the special education numbers that we have. So ideally, the reg is if you have 15 kids in an integrated preschool program, 7 with special education needs and 8 typical. So you balance it out that way, and then you can go up from there.
You won't know that for a few months.
No, I shouldn't have. It is a challenge and it is complicated and there's a lot to think about with that, but we have 2 birth to 3 providers in the area region criterion that we have great relationships with. So I already know by initial, I don't know by name because of confidentiality, that there's a couple that live in Whately, let's say, and there's 5 that live in Deerfield. And the year that they were born and a little bit of some kind of profile that I need to get a heads up about. And then about a year before they start transitioning, these early facilities have parents sign a waiver so I can start meeting the family and going into the home and seeing the needs and going to playgroup and talking about a child and bringing Chrissy aboard with me, or maybe Sally comes, that kind of thing. So we don't go in blind. We also screen our kids. We are done with our preschool screenings by the end of October. And I have to say, this team does an amazing job with screening. They're very fine-tuned. I only have a 3-year perspective or 2-point perspective, but we've been right on with our findings each time, have been able to start early intervention outside the special education process to support kids when they're really, really ready, you know, really. valuable to do that. So we don't go in totally blind, but there may be challenges. And if a child comes in from another town that for some reason slipped and we didn't get the early data that I should have because I didn't, you know, and then we'd have to make a different plan. It will likely be that I would work with their hometown to have a transition with that child to go there.
You mentioned that Sunderland's going to have two full days.
Yeah.
So do you think that there's enough demand if you're going to open up two over there and one here?
There is so much demand. There really is for quality.
Mm-hmm.
District-wide, our preschools are amazing. Mm. When you walk into those classrooms, they are amazing. They're so child-centered. When I had the state come and visit, I had Amanda Thayer come here, and you know, she pulled over to say how awesome this program is. It's just, we get accolades all the time for that. And this is new if we're open to neighboring towns. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't do that. We don't accept kids from Greenfield in our Deerfield program, or from Berniston in our Sunderland program. We just don't do that. So that's new that we do here. Mm-hmm. And it might be a nice real fit for this type of town and school choice and the diversity that you build within your school.
And what do you think for the summer? You mentioned the 8 to 3 during the school year.
Yeah, so again, the purpose of preschool is to make sure that we're providing effective early intervention for our kids, but there's many, many other things that go on, and the socialization, the early learning, and figuring out how to be in a group, and talk in a group, and problem solve in a group. So by philosophy, we would keep that going in a summer program, and Pete, you housed our summer program from Deerfield. We had 2 full-day classrooms, and we had 28 kids, I think, separated in 2 of those classrooms. So we have to provide services for special education if the team deems that is what we need to do over the summer to prevent regression. So then if we have an existing program with a cohort of wonderful kids to embed the services in the children, and it would be wonderful to do in Whately. If for some reason the numbers didn't look like people wanted that summer, we could look at it differently and go back. So I've surveyed the parents already about the upcoming year enrollment, just a general one, but very specific for summer enrollment. We would start doing that at the end of January. We like to get our numbers in well ahead of time to plan for staffing and activities.
Mm-hmm. And there would be added cost because we don't do summer now? Or
what's happened in my Deerfield program is between special education funding and grants and tuition. Uh-huh.
It covers it.
I had another question. I'm searching for it. Bob, maybe you can ask a question and it'll come to me.
Well, when we have Penny talk about some numbers, maybe that question will come up.
All right.
Well, can I just ask one quick question? Do the preschoolers take the bus now?
No, not allowed. If we, as a special education team, deem that this child has to have access to our program to help support the disability, then we provide transportation if the parents didn't have
it. Separate.
Separate. From the big bus. Yeah, and they're little cars that go through. Right now it's Joan Baker's transportation.
But these could also be added children to the lunch. They could be.
Yes.
Helping
new
to
customers.
Buy lunch. New customers. Yes. Because they don't buy lunch now.
Yes, and I think
But also we did discuss at this age they wouldn't go to the cafeteria.
We would
bring the lunch to the room.
Right. My daughter went to the Deerfield preschool, so yes. I can imagine what it would be like. She didn't have Chris.
I don't know.
It'll come to you.
It came back twice. I'm just overwhelmed. Kim, thank you, and I appreciate your candidness about the sped situation, because that's a little risky, but I think it's worthwhile. So, you want to talk about money?
Sure. So none of my numbers include summer, because that wasn't part of our conversation.
Yeah, and it's an unknown. Yeah. Nobody's been surveyed in Whately for summer. It's just an unknown.
Right.
So what I did was I took a look at where we are with our tuition revolving account. And we utilize this money now to offset the cost of our early childhood teacher. And it ebbs and flows based on how much money we have in there. So to begin this fiscal year, we started the year with $10,063. We're projecting $21,600 based on our half-day program right now. Now, that's not definitive. It could be a little higher, could be a little lower if we get a new ad or someone drops. So I'm going to go with a conservative 21.6. So that would give us $31,663 for the year. And we had budgeted that $17,000 is what we would allocate toward that salary. So that would leave us this year $14,663. So I would recommend that of that $14,000 this year, we would allocate the money to do the advertising and the marketing and do the startup costs, which would take $3,000 from that $14,663. I did just notice that if we're not on to vote on this tonight, but if we waited to the January meeting, we're going to miss the whole window to advertise and market because we're signing, parents are looking to sign their kids up in January. So it's not on here for a vote, so I don't know if we can consider that for tonight. But I know the conversations I've had with Kim and Rhonda, we need to do the marketing now. Now is the time that we need to do that, or we're going to miss the window for next year. So if you turn the page, what I did was then take the if we use the $3,000 for the startup, we would begin this next year at $11,663, give or take. And I built our tuition projections based on 11 full-time students. Now, so I'm not taking into account if we get any part-timers. Based on who qualifies now in our town, five would be full pays and six would be the discounted, at the discounted rate. So even at that, we would bring in $55,440. In FY18, I was going to propose that we spend $20,000 out of this for our EC teacher, and then the balance would be in our budget, which it already is. So it's not adding anything to our budget. Then we would need the instructional assistant. They already exist. They're in our budget. It doesn't change. We would need $300 for screening supplies. We could take that out of the revolving account. And we would need to increase our current budget of $500 to $1,000. So $500 would come from tuition and $500 would stay in our budget. So we're not going to affect our budget by going full day if we get the students. Now the extended day is different. So if we need to add the care coordinator, that would be about $18,000, and we would need another half-time instructional assistant, which would be about $11,077. So that would mean we need additional funding of $29,077. So I did the break-even point. If we did $15 a day times 180 days, that's $2,700. So if I divide that by the cost, we need 11 kids in the extended day program to make that break-even. Now understand, we may need to ramp that up. So worst case scenario, if we had to use the tuition revolving account to cover that $29,000, we'd still end up at the end of next year at $17,000 surplus in the revolving account. And I'm saying we're probably not going to have to do that. There's good, if nobody comes to extended day, then we don't hire anybody.
Right. And you didn't factor in the revenue that you might get.
Exactly. I left the revenue out.
From the extended care.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm sorry.
No, if you get your question, you go.
Well, I actually came back to me. I wrote it down too. Hurry up. And I have another one.
Hurry up.
Which I'm losing now. But so. What's your experience with the numbers for extended day programs? Do most of the parents do it or not?
In Deerfield, we can go as high as 20 kids in an afternoon. So I have four staff in there, sometimes five. We staff up for that time of day. I use one coordinator at that $20, and then I fill in with IAs that work in the district that would like to make more money, but still within our
But the question, Kim, is what percent of our kids
so
stay to the extended day?
We have 44 all day and about 20.
20, so about half.
That's
about half of them.
All day.
Okay. And the other question that was eluding me a couple of times, you said that parents support the idea of a full day program. When they were asked that question, I'm assuming you asked, would you take part in that, partake in that program?
So the trick of it is that some are going on to kindergarten, right?
You're right.
Right, next year. So they would say, if you had it last year, I would have, right? And I had one family that is in Deerfield now that said that they would move their child here for next year if you could build it. So they'd pull out of the program that year.
And would you direct people, like, if Deerfield was full, to think about Whately or Sunderland?
Especially when you have those layers. So Whately residents first slot, then we have our frontier community, then we have our neighboring community. That's how we set it up in our mind. And then we would do a wait list and, you know, a lottery. And, you know, there's lots of factors that go into that, male, female, you know, all those kinds.
We'll get to that point when we,
when we get a big old wait list.
So when we have, from a financial perspective, I definitely think we can do this. And using our conservative numbers. When we did this program in FY12, I had just come at that point, and I think looking back, which of course hindsight is 2020, it didn't take off the first year, and I think we have to prepare ourselves that this may not take off the first year, but I think we pulled the plug too early, because I think, you know, there was a lot of situations that we were planning on that year, a business closing that never closed, so I just want to prepare you that everything may not be peachy the first year, but it's going to be a ramp up, and I think it's going. And I definitely think it's going to be a success, and I definitely think the need is there because we're bursting at the seams in our other three towns.
And I get a lot of phone calls from neighboring towns looking for the quality that we stand for, and we have not really been able to do that this year. We did a nice job with those kids that are coming now.
I think we should vote on it.
I do too.
Even though it's not on the agenda, I think we should vote it.
Can I ask one question though? It does hinge on Pete not needing more people.
Right.
Really, at the end of the day, in terms of the costs, not.
From the 8 to 3, we are golden. It's the extended day that we need to add some services.
Right, but Pete, you're sort of taking people away from Pete to
stay. No, with his permission. We've got two IAs in the building right now that we don't need next year. So we would be looking to reduce them. So before we reduce them, we're going to reutilize them.
Right.
One of them is going to go to early childhood. One of them is going to help the one remaining special education inclusion person deliver service.
Right. And the Chrissy moving full-time, though?
She's already full-time. It's just we're shifting her.
I know,
right,
but you're taking her out of the special ed.
Right, so that's why
just
we're adding an IA.
Remind ourselves, that to me is the risk, is that if
what are
Chrissy
two risks,
really
I see,
needed,
you know, an increase in SPED population within
right,
the school
require more
could affect the number of people that she could service
right,
with a reaction that we have to put on somebody else to
right,
fill that void.
That's right.
And the other one,
the demand, you know, the ultimate question.
You know,
how many people
and I trust that what you're saying,
it sounds like you have good
the demand is there. So,
yeah, and it's
I'm not going to come beat you with a club.
No,
I don't come.
Are you going to beat me for the money?
Well, the numbers better be right, back.
Hey, we know where your office is, so.
She's moving.
If everything falls into place and we have an enrollment of 11 children in our extended care portion of the day, that really allows, so we have the extended day coordinators start early. He or she would work a 5 day, so it would overlap with the public school day, and it would build capacity for Chrissy to maintain or maintain some of her special education caseload, test new kids, maybe consult on some reading program, so that builds in a little bit more flexibility with that person. But that, again, is all dependent on the numbers coming in for that.
Chrissy's here tonight, so I'm assuming that you're okay with this whole change, the
yes,
idea of the change. You want a happy
case right,
in our program.
It's always part of it.
All right. I'll make a motion to for FY17-18 go to full day preschool program.
I second that.
Do you want to include the extended program in that, or?
Sure.
With the extended program.
Yep.
So that's part of your motion.
Yes. Yes, sir.
So we have a motion to start up a full day program in the next fiscal year. and to offer an extended day program as well in that program. So, we have any further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
That's great.
There you go.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. I so support this. I am beyond thrilled. This is where it really, really, the rubber's going to hit the road. These kids really need it.
Well, you know, for the general public, all the research says that it happens in preschool. That's where you catch them and you really can make a difference, so.
And I'll add too, I know I mentioned this at a previous meeting, but we talk a lot about the quality of the program and the care that kids get. And at least one recent study that I'm familiar with, I think I shared this with you before, parents want a daycare that's convenient for them to get to. And the biggest thing is they want people that are going to love their kids. Mm-hmm. They don't think about a lot of the stuff that we think about. They just want a place where, and we can market safe. That mm-hmm. because we have a lot of parents that are very, very happy with what we've done.
Right. There's very good positive word of mouth, which is great.
So, ladies, thank you very much.
Thank you.
You know, congratulations on maintaining a wonderful program.
Get a lot of more work to do.
Yeah, all right. If you don't mind, we're going to move to the 3 to 5 year plan so that Bob can get out of here. And then we'll bring up the school lunch.
He's here at the crack of dawn every day. He works nonstop.
So, Bob, you're on again, I guess.
Okay. What I've tried to do is put the Whately School on a similar format that I've used in the high school. I want to show just a group of projects and a rough time frame for them. And then I've got that first block of projects that are less than 1 year costed out, and we can talk about where we might fund that from. But basically what I've done is I've shown some projects that I think ought to be taken care of in the next year. I've shown a group of projects that are things that I think you should be aware of in the next 2 to 5 years, and then I've showed a group of projects that are things that, you know, in 5 years or so are going to be there. So every year we should be taking stuff off of this list or adding things onto it and keeping an ongoing idea of what's going in the building. I met with Pete. I think I've got most everything on here that he wanted, and it's a list I've been keeping for the school here for a couple of years. I've just never formalized it in a way that I could present it. One thing that you'll notice isn't on here is a price on every project. I've got an idea of how much some of these things cost, but it's incredibly difficult to try to put numbers on all of these things. As we discuss this tonight or in future meetings, you can say to me, you know, these are things that we agree with and are interested in, and we'd like to see you spend some time trying to price them out and give us better information. So with that said, I think I'm just gonna, I don't know at this point that it makes sense or you really want me to go through every single project. I think what, you know, you can do is take a look at this. I'll be glad to come back to a future meeting and talk some more and answer questions. And I think the project funding recommendations are something that we're going to need to work with Patty on and try to figure out if some of this stuff, you know, if all of these things are things we want to do, we got to figure out how we're going to budget for them and where we're going to get the money.
Can some of the money come out of the capital improvement, sure.
Mm-hmm. Well, the first thought that I had here is, you know, I appreciate
this is Yeah.
This is really helpful. If we have big ticket items, mm-hmm. then we need to think about letting the town know that, mm-hmm. that if we're going to look to, you know, capital improvement funds to do that, we need to do it early on and not wait like for this year and say, oh, we need it next year, because we're never going to get it.
Yep,
we need to plan ahead of time, right. And say, and I know, for example, the driveway in here, it's starting to really deteriorate. And that's something that's going to be, need to be done, and I see you're, I think you're calling it 5 years out. It's now, it's time to say, when we get a letter from the town saying, what are your capital expenses going to be, that you say, within the next 5 years, we got to replace the driveway. So they know about it, we get on the list. You know, it goes back to that bone business. We finally get on the list, and we'll see if we actually move up the ladder on getting the project done. But unless we notify them, we'll never get these projects done, because other departments have equal demands as well.
So one of the things that I have a question about is that we I believe we got Whately's letter, because I know we got the rest, I know we've got a couple other towns. Do we have to resubmit the phone system again, or is it already in the pipeline?
I don't think it hurts to resubmit it, honestly.
I say you remind them that it's there.
Okay.
Okay.
And did we ever have a capital, did we ever start here, like I know some of the other towns, where every year we ask for a warrant article to put money in a capital account?
We never have here, and I wish we would.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then my last question is something that just came up from the special town meeting the other night. One of the finance members, I reminded them that we've never finished the emergency generator here, because they had decided to put a hold, because when Bob and I did the thing, it came in extremely higher.
Yeah, I keep asking about that, too.
And so we turned it over to them and said, listen, it's your emergency center. So then there was talk that if they bought that building, it would move over there. And I said to them, that may not be the best idea, because you have no kitchen facilities. Mm-hmm. But the question back to me was, did we ever set up a fund? Is there money on account at the town? I cannot recall.
I can't remember if they voted.
Nothing.
I don't think they voted.
We used the grant to have the study done for the costs. But no one else recalls there being a fund, right?
No, I don't recall.
What I heard about the generator was they didn't want to do gas and they didn't want to do diesel because of flammability. Well, the next thing is how much propane tanks can we have out there then if we're going to run it on propane, because we can't get natural gas.
We have natural gas.
We have?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we use. So there's the answer right there, is natural gas to run a generator where it's
that's
not...
That's what we did, isn't it?
There were a bunch of issues with the natural gas. At the time we were looking at it, the issue with the gas was the location of the service versus the location of the generator. Now I think since then, the gas suppliers have put that moratorium on increased services. So I think there'd be some negotiation about the increased amount of gas. I'm not positive about that. And
I just got some bid prices, and no one told me anything about a moratorium.
But as I recall, the last time we looked at it, it became a propane generator if we did it, because it was cheaper to put a propane tank than it was to extend the gas.
I remember that.
Right.
And
you know, they would have to drill through the, go through the cellar, over to it and stuff. And you were talking about couplers and.
Okay. So what I'll do, to put the emergency generator, what I will do is I will talk with Ray Ellsworth, who's the town accountant, and ask him if there's any funds on the book somewhere for that generator. Okay, sorry, I didn't mean to digress, but it just kicked me into memory.
Going back to what Bob said, I mean, I think we need to get some numbers on some of these. You know, I mean, we understand they're ballpark figures, but something that we could pass on to the town so that when we start to present our ideas, it's there for them. It's not sitting here.
And I think what I would ask for is some guidance from you as to which ones you see as the ones I should focus on.
I mean, maybe next meeting we could.
I think they're due before the next meeting. That's the problem. I think they're due to back to the town by like the end of this month.
Well, we understand. I mean, you're talking about these other ones in the future.
Right.
We're talking about doing something like the carpet is for $15,000. So that's a capital improvement, right? Is that what you were talking about?
Should we put that one on the list?
Yeah.
When you say 1 year.
I mean, that's the most expensive one is that at $15,000. All the other ones are $5,000 or less.
And we can move around some of those. The only number there that I, you know, the snowblower is a fixed amount of money. the door frames, we can pick and choose how many we do to start off and make that number what we want it to be. The flooring upgrades are the same thing. We can, you know, we can make that what we want to get done. The roof on the storage shed, I think, is something we really got to do. We got a lot of stuff stored in there.
Is it, my question was, is the plywood rotted also, or is it just moss grown on top of?
I'm hoping it did. I haven't heard any complaints about active leaks in there, which amazes me when you look at the condition of that roof.
It's a strip job, and
so hopefully it's pretty straightforward.
Do you know who squares off the top of your head?
I don't off the top of my head. I should have written that down, but I did get a price from a roofer that we used.
Okay.
So just so you know, Bob, the yearly roof inspection, we put that in the budget for this year.
Okay.
That's in there.
Yep.
We increased the line item last year by $4,000. Two because of the cost of supplies, and two for the roofing inspection.
Okay.
So that money's in your budget
okay.
to get that done.
Good.
And when you say 1 year, is that next fiscal year that
well,
we're talking
see,
about? Or is that,
you know, I think
we put it in for 17.
Once we get doing a good job on the roof, we're only going to probably have to do it every 2 or 3 years. But so I've tried to break it down that, you know, if you have $1,500 a year, you might not spend that every year. But you will at 2 years or 3 years end up with a program where they're coming out here. But you know, we had them do that work just about a year ago, I think. And I've already heard that there's some work that still needs to be done. So I've been trying to get him to come back here and do some more, do a little bit more. But you know, this having that yearly maintenance account is really great. It's like the money that we talked about having some sort of endowment for these bigger, you know, the projects that are in that 3 to 5 year range. It's very difficult to predict when those are going to go critical, but if the town was putting aside a chunk of money every year, that would grow as an endowment. When one of these things came up to be needed, it would be pretty easy to say, okay, we've got $60,000 in this account, and now this thing is needed, we're going to spend this $15,000 to do it.
So can I make a recommendation just for your consideration? If we take the snow blower, the door frames, and the roof, because we already know the yearly roof inspection is taken care of, if we took care of the other three items, it totals $9,300. Right now, we're showing a savings in our school choice budget for the year of about $22,762. Now, I won't have, at the end of this month, I will get our number, it's our actual revenue numbers for this year. So if they're good and we've got more money than we thought we were going to get, we could probably take care of that $9,300 with school choice money, and then put the phone system and the floor upgrades to the town for a warrant article.
What about the roof replacement?
I'm saying the roof.
Roof.
The $5,000 for the roof, $2,500 for the door, $1,800 for the snowblower. That's $9,300.
Well, we already got $4,000 in the general account to do the roof, I thought.
Yes, but the roof and other things that we were having increased costs.
Okay.
So I'm saying let's just leave that. That's taken care of. $1,500. We take the $5,000 for the roof, the $2,500 for the doors, and the $1,800 for the snowblower. I'm saying I think we're in pretty good shape that we could take that $9,300 from school choice. But in January, I'll have exact numbers of what our financial picture looks like for school choice this year, because I'll get the accounting for what we filed on the October 1st census.
So you're saying, basically what you're saying is to push up the flooring upgrades to capital improvement.
Along with the phone system, submit those to those two things for the town, and then we take care of the other three items, and the $1,500 is already done. We've already got that money in our budget.
And can you just clarify again, when are these expenses hitting? Are these going to hit?
This year.
Like this fiscal year?
This fiscal year.
Mm-hmm. But we could wait to see the school choice numbers. Snowblower you might want to buy, but
right, I think we should buy the snowblower because we're going to need that
How
now.
How old is the snowblower?
There's an old John Deere snowblower that's been here.
Is it a track?
I think it may be. I'm not sure. But you know, the bottom line with that is we might get another couple of years out of it.
Well, the reason I asked Bob is that's the one we bought when
If we lose it, yeah, it's probably the same one, yeah. If we lose it halfway through the season.
But it's been around for a long.
It'll be a crisis. So, you know, I just find that that's something that, you know, we get 6 inches of snow and we're trying to get school open.
Right, we need two, it would be nice if we had two snow blowers going if we get a lot of snow.
Well, I want to have one good one running.
So, okay, let me amend my, let me amend that.
We won't trade that one in.
Take $1,800 now from school choice and buy a new snow blower before we get buried. The $2,500 and $5,000, the $7,500, we'll put off till January when we know our school choice numbers. We'll take the $15,000 for the flooring and the phones and submit those to the town for warrant articles.
Okay, just keep in mind that the things that you're submitting for warrant capital improvement items won't, I guarantee you, I mean, I'm on that committee. I know how they operate, and I don't see them moving those up, maybe. But I think they like to look at something a year or two out.
But did they look at the phone last year?
I'm saying, don't count on the 15 grand for the carpets getting in on this next warrant.
But we'll know, if it makes the, we'll know if they're recommended for warrant, and then we can go back to the drawing board and figure out what we're gonna do.
But I, you know, I, again, I'd like to stay away from school choice as much as we can.
I do understand that.
Because we really need a little nest egg in case there's a major expense that comes along.
Well, that's why I'm saying, I think the $1,800, we need to spend now. So if we spend that out of the school choice until I get the December financials for the school choice, we'll be able to make a better decision about how much we'll have as our nest egg in school choice. So we'll push off those off till January or February, till we can nail down those numbers. And then we submit the flooring, and if it gets on the, we'll know whether it gets on the warrant. If it doesn't make it on the warrant, then maybe what we do is we focus, if we have any year-end savings, that goes towards the flooring project.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll do at least one or two rooms with whatever we have as savings. We make that the priority.
Because, you know, what I'm the reason I wanted to see this, and I go back to, I'll use the snowblower as an example. Last year when we were doing the budget, nobody said anything about a snowblower.
Right.
And now, you know, we're getting into the season, and now we're saying we need a snowblower.
Right.
So, I mean, that's why I wanted something like this.
I agree with you, Don, because my next suggestion is if we take what he's saying this year, then we pick one or two items for the 2 to 5 that we think that we could add to our budget for FY18.
If not the budget, then capital improvements.
Right.
Yeah, but we're already saying we got to get the flooring and the phones first before we get anything
else. But say
planning years out.
You're requesting. Right.
I'm going to put the
2 years from now, so 3 years from now.
I think we should do two things with the town. Put the two items we want on this year's warrant, but also give them the five-year plan and say, this is what our five-year plan looks like.
But you're not getting what I'm saying. Because you give them two things now, doesn't mean it'll get on this year's warrant. That's why it's important that you decide on the major things that you want. You tell them now that it may be 5 years out before you need it.
Right.
So but at least gets in there, in the pool.
Right, which is what we did with the phones, which is, for me, critical.
And what I'm saying, and I'm agreeing with you, and I think I'm saying it a different way. So even though we know we won't get the phones and the flooring both this year, we submit them both. But we also tell the Capital Planning Committee, this is our five-year plan. So start looking down the road, because next year we're going to ask for these two items, and the year after that we're going to ask for these two items,
yeah,
and the year after that we're going to ask for these two items.
I don't think it would hurt if the Capital Improvement Committee got a copy of it.
Exactly.
Right. That's right.
And I would encourage any feedback I can get from anyone. You know, some of these things are somewhat, if you get out to the 2 to 3 and 3 to 5, they become subjective. I mean, you're balancing need against the possibility that something might fail. Especially on the need perspective, getting input is important.
I also wonder if the emergency generator even really belongs to us to put on a capital improvement.
It doesn't.
Plan.
I've already kicked it to them.
Yeah.
I've already kicked it to them, Pete.
Well, we can remove it from the list, in other words. I mean, we all want to see it happen.
Bob,
it's not ours to.
When we talk about the phone system, does that include the clock and the intercom?
Well, yes and no. at one time, when it was first installed, it might have been that way. I'm finding that most of these systems now, I can purchase them better if I buy them individually. So, you know, I think I would not say buy the phones and include all of that stuff from that one vendor.
Is the intercom and the phone system the same?
I mean, I imagine the clocks could be separate, but what, I don't know. I imagine we could get a phone system that has an intercom as well.
It really depends what we end up buying and who we negotiate with and how we do it. You know, right now, we're putting a new phone system in the high school, and it has nothing to do with the intercom that's in there. We may end up in a smaller school like this using phones that have the audio portion on the phones as opposed to up in the walls. And so that's a difficult, I'm kind of a fan of making it look like more rather than less. And then if we get some sort of a good way.
Do we have a cost estimate that we put in for the phone?
We did, I think we put it in last year, and I might have it on my computer.
But I guess
that might be the thing to update.
We need to redefine that, because I think one of the problems Pete was talking about here was the ineffectualness of our current intercom system.
The difference with Frontier
to connect in times of an emergency.
Sure. Frontier may I don't know, but they may have a perfectly good working intercom system, which is why they were able to replace their phones. I'm proposing that both are problematic in our building.
And I'm hoping that lump sum will take care of both.
If the phone system can take care of both, then we just have those wall phones removed, and we somehow connect the phones to the speakers, and that would be great. But I think what Bob is saying is, well, you know, maybe connecting the phone system to the speakers is more complicated than we think, and it might be easier to buy a new intercom system. I don't know. But we need both. That's the point I want to make.
That's the point I was trying to make.
Try to kill two birds with one stone.
Sometimes with the phone, the intercom can go right through the phone.
Yeah, right. And as long as we end up with both, because they're both safety issues.
We're trying right now in the high school with central offices moving over to get a new phone system for the people in central offices and to fix some issues in the phone system at the high school. And, you know, Scott Paul's been working with me on it. It's become a very complicated project. At first, we thought going voice over internet was going to be a great solution, and then that didn't work. And then we thought that buying a switch through Verizon in the switching station right next to the high school was going to work great, and that fell apart. Some of the schools end up being the biggest phone system in these small towns in some cases, and so it gets a little complicated making decisions on how we do it.
We can go on, well, you would know, Frontier, around and around with the phone system at Frontier, the interfacing with...
Did you buy the Patty?
No, I don't remember if I did it or if Marty did it.
So I want to think it was... I want to say 16,000, but I could be wrong.
I can have Brian pull it, so I'll get on that tomorrow.
All right. Well, I guess.
Well, let's make a motion to take $18,000 for a new snowblower.
$1,800.
Excuse me. Nice. I wanted Pete to have a nice drive jacked her, but no. $1,800 for a new snowblower out of school choice money.
Okay.
So this is what they already have. This is a worksheet that came from the town, I'm pretty sure. Patty?
It's 30,000.
30,000. I just found it. February 19th, we put in 30,000. The Whately Elementary School is requesting to replace its phone clock intercom system. The equipment is original to the building and is at its end of useful life. The new system will be able to provide better communication throughout the building on a daily basis and is crucial to emergency situations.
Perfect.
So we will resubmit that one.
But I think in the meantime, since that's been in there now 2 years, we really need to decide, start looking at
priorities.
what kind of system we want and a good ballpark figure of what it's going to cost.
Well, and the timing about looking on our phone system is perfect. We're going to get a lot of experience in Frontier, and working with Scott's been very useful because phone systems are going from something that used to be completely independent of computers, and you know, now there's an interface between the two, and so I think by the first of next year we should have some good ideas on who good vendors are and what we'd be looking for a system here.
So Bob, could you send to me the $15,000 for the floor, how many classrooms that would take care of, and what you're planning to remove carpet and upgrade it to, just so I can prepare the capital project request form?
Are we going to carpet, or are we going to
No, we're going from tile? Carpet to tile.
Yes, thank you.
Mm-hmm. But they'll want some information, so I can't just say that.
Yeah. There's a motion on the table for the $1,800 for a snowblower out of school choice this year.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, I'll put down Katie a second.
Yep.
Okay.
I would highly think if you had to put a bid, go out for bid on this $1,800 for a snowblower?
What I've done is there's a couple of good places locally. We've been buying a whole bunch of places, stuff from Padula up in Greenfield, and then there's another good vendor out the other side of Conway. So what I'll do is
I'll give AI a chance. I mean, it's Club Cadet or whatever, but you know, I know engines in these things are the biggest thing. Mm-hmm. I'm a Honda guy. I mean, I think Honda engines are the best. And I, you know, you can get a price from the place in Northampton cycle.
From my perspective, what we've been specifying very carefully is a commercial grade unit. That makes all the difference in the world for what you get for your train and motor and all of that sort of stuff if you buy the commercial line.
Yep.
So, you know, Aaron's has a good commercial line. There's several of them.
Okay.
And so that's exactly what we'll specify. And it'll be something that, you know, it'll be a good blower with electric start and all that sort of stuff.
Good. Thanks.
So do you want to make another motion for the administration to submit the phones and the flooring to the capital request?
I don't think we need to make a motion on that.
Okay, just do it.
We'll instruct you to.
Okay.
Submit those to or whatever to the capital improvement plan.
Okay. With a copy of this plan as well.
Okay. Any a comment about that? Now we'll move on.
Great. So Don or Bob or Katie, if you feel there's something on here that you're aware of that you don't see on here, please feel free to email us and we can add it on there if you feel that we're missing something.
You want something off.
The only other thought I have is to create something similar for technology, because I do think things are kind of shifting between facilities and technology.
Scott already has it done. He's got
that might be something
to
share in the future also. Yes. We'll need to think about funding those as well.
Well, we're meeting with him. I got his budget today, and we'll be meeting with him Friday to do his budget.
Okay. So maybe in a future.
Most of his stuff we've been putting in the budget.
In the regular budget.
Yeah.
Correct. Right. So unless his plans are to increase what we currently have in the budget, mm-hmm. you won't hear from us.
Okay.
Okay. So we need to talk about the price of school lunches.
Yes.
As you may recall.
So moved.
Patty reported to us that
thanks, Bob.
We are undercharging in our school lunches what the feds consider a reasonable amount, like 10 cents.
Right. So right now we're undercharging by 3 cents.
3 cents.
But every year the target moves. So every year our free lunch reimbursement increases. We can't charge less than what the feds are reimbursing us. So if we did a 5 cent increase from 275 to 280, that might just cover us till next year. If we did the 10 cents now, it's going to buy us probably 3 years before we have to move again. And I know what we heard in the survey is not what parents want to hear, that there's an increase. However, we don't have a choice where this is concerned.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess I wouldn't interpret the survey to say that people don't understand that might need to pay more. I think if the quality, if the other pieces go up because of having more funding, then that would be a positive. And it did seem like they might be willing to pay for that, given that expense was not the overriding factor.
And I did talk with our three, we have, in the four towns, we have three food service directors, and this only affects the elementary lunch pricing. Our high school pricing is all set, and they all agreed that the 10 cents would be to them an agreeable amount that they would, if they had requested it themselves, they would be looking for 10 cents.
What's the other schools at right now?
Everybody's at 275.
I make a motion to raise it from 275 to 285.
Effective January.
January 1st.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay.
You gonna sign something?
Oh, I'm gonna talk about the amendment to the instructional assistance agreement.
Okay, you want me to take that one?
Yeah.
Okay.
I gave it to you there.
I have it here.
All right, so when we, this new contract we have for instructional assistance, there was a proposal for certain instructional assistants who worked in specialized programs or who had specialized duties to receive an additional hourly stipend, one-hour stipend of pay a day. The way that the contract was written, it reads, at the sole discretion of the superintendent, the unit members working in the specialized programs and or have, will be paid for the additional hour. The way the Franklin County Retirement Board reads this is that the wages are discretionary, which makes them non-pensionable for our employees. So when they retire, these wages would not be included in their pension allotment. So that was not our intent to not have them pensionable. So we worked with the Franklin County Retirement Board, told them that the intent was not to make the wage discretion, but the wage earners are discretionary. They didn't care what our intent was. They don't like the word discretion. So their attorney and our attorney worked up this agreement, and our union agreed to it. And we're asking you tonight to vote to change the language so that it's clear that the earnings are not discretionary and they will become pensionable for our employees with the Franklin County Retirement Board. Mm-hmm. So we need a vote and the chair's signature.
I make a motion to amend the instructional assistant agreement.
I second that.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Yeah. Donald sign it.
Do you want to keep this?
Okay.
I do.
You know, this is a long meeting.
It is the longest meeting I've been in.
All right,
I'm hoping my stomach is growling.
Brief, we'll have some brief
very
reports from our superintendent and principal. I have nothing to report.
Good. Okay.
Collaborative? No? You're first.
Okay.
So I don't.
Okay. So my notes are fairly well annotated this month. And I also gave you a handout so that you could familiarize yourself with how our medical emergency team works. And quite frankly, I chose this as my principal's report because as I was sitting with a list of things that I wanted to discuss with you, most of them were on the agenda elsewhere this month. So I decided to give you a safety update. I look back, I'm not sure I really gave you much of one this year except for the very beginning of the year when we did our bus evacuation. But this will update you a little bit, you know, where we are in terms of our safety updates. As you know, safety is extremely important to me, and we spend a lot of time making sure that we're keeping the saw sharp in that area. Just this afternoon, several of us were trained in CPR. Wednesday is first aid. Our new nurse, Esty McCoy, is excellent and really keeping us on our toes when it comes to our medical emergency drills. And we just revamped the plan. That's why I wanted you to have it. But again, it's just a little reminder for you folks on some of the things that we need to do out of necessity and because it's the right thing to do. And just wanted to keep you updated on that. That's really all I had for you. So unless medical emergencies have been on your mind, if you have some questions about it, I'm glad to entertain them. But I really just wanted to keep you filled in on where we stand. The last one, evacuation and reunification, is a drill that we have not done in our school ever. It's a fairly new drill to, you know, the whole state and the state police, but it's coming. And it's not going to be an easy drill to run, but we're going to try it.
What is it referred to?
It essentially, you do a mock school evacuation. You don't do the whole school. You pick maybe a classroom or two. Mm-hmm. And reunification. We evacuate a portion of the building, put them on a bus, take them to another location. Uh-huh. We have volunteer parents even who show up to pick up their kids. It involves a lot of people, Katie, as you mm-hmm. might imagine, in mm-hmm. the event of a real emergency. Again, knock on wood and hope that we never have to go through a real emergency, but in a real emergency in the age of cell phones, word gets out very quickly and concerned parents will get in their cars and come to a location to say, where's my kid? I want to take my kid home. Right. And by the time that most parents get here, police will already be here, tape will be up, parents won't be allowed in. Doing the emergency evacuation drill involves letting the community know that in the event of an emergency, you're not going to get close to the school. We're going to keep you away. We want you to drive to this location, and we will bring your kids there. And then parents have to show appropriate ID, get the kids out of there. It's very involved. It includes staff that greets parents, staff that run to get kids. It's pretty involved. So that's coming. But anyway, that's all I have for you.
All right. Well done.
Thank you.
All right. Do you have anything for the collaborative or?
Nope.
Okay. Good. All right. Superintendent's report.
My report is also very short tonight. The Frontier School Committee, the central office staff, and I would like to thank the members of the Whately community for supporting the move to Frontier Regional School by voting the warrant article at your special town meeting on December 1st. I'm sorry I wasn't there. I wanted to be there. I was at a superintendent's award meeting, dinner at Franklin Tech. So on that note, we are making the final preparations for moving to central office, roughly two and a half weeks, moving to the Frontier Regional Campus. The movers will be at our building on Christian Lane Friday, December 23rd, and Monday, December 26th, if need be. We will be in our new space on the 27th, and we'll be operational. We'll be doing what needs to be done. However, the office will be closed during that week when there's no school so that we can really settle in and unpack. We will reopen to the public on January 3rd, and we're excited about it, of course, and we want to thank everyone for their support during this time.
Just a question, since Monday's the legal holiday, mm-hmm. who's working for you guys? Or?
Just me.
Okay. Because it is, I don't know.
Yeah. Nope. Just, Bob. Bob and I will be doing, okay. Bob and I will be working.
With the movers.
Just overseeing, yeah. There's not much anybody else can really do. It's really a kind of a, you know, they'll have been packed and everything. Everything yeah. will be in a box. And again, back to the bus safety. You know, as we have all been really aware, heightened awareness about the need for to ensure bus safety for our students, we're currently looking at investigating bus safety curriculum. And there are several of them we can choose. But we want to get a bus safety curriculum that we can use with all our students to help them understand the importance of being good bus passengers. We plan to use the curriculum along with a review of all the safety procedures that they already have, really helping them understand the expectations of being allowed to ride the bus. It is a service we provide. It is not necessarily, it's more of a privilege than, a guaranteed right. And we want to help everyone to remember that being a good passenger mm-hmm. makes for a much safer ride.
Mm-hmm. Do we ever have, like, monitors on the bus to, like you do in classrooms?
On special education buses, we do. And in some circumstances, if we're having difficulties, if we're transitioning a rider from a special education bus to a big bus, we will have a temporary monitor. In my conversations with Mr. Gribko, he sees monitors on the bus, on regular school buses, as something that may be coming down the line from the state. Because as we're seeing more behaviors in a classroom, those same behaviors happen on a bus.
Right.
And we're not expecting a teacher, we're expecting a bus driver who's driving a 75-passenger bus to drive
and
deal with behaviors at the same time. So Mr. Gribko really feels it's something, like maybe in the next bus contract, we may want to consider it.
Yeah.
Or at least, you know, on certain routes where we have issues.
Mm-hmm.
But I really think that if we, as Dr. Carey said, and if we really start teaching our kids, like how do, you know, the school day doesn't end just because you're out of the classroom. The behavior we expect in the classroom is the behavior we expect on the bus. So if we do our part in teaching our students how to be good passengers, and Gribko LLC does their part and make sure their drivers will do everything, I think we can make it a better environment for and a safer environment for everyone.
Right. And one thought was just surprise, like if somebody just rides the bus once a month, to just sort of put the kids on alert, like other people are watching. I don't know if that.
What if Gribko has? Do they have cameras?
No.
That'll come before the monitor.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, it makes a difference.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
It really does.
So when Johnny's not misbehaving, Mike, and the mom says, mom or dad says, oh, he doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But it also...
But the bus driver needs backup,
keeps the bus driver honest,
right.
Too.
Yeah, and I see that happening.
When do they take the cameras out? I mean, they used to be in the bus.
They're not, I don't believe, we have the capacity to have a camera on the, I believe all his buses are camera ready, but we've never asked him to have cameras all the time. So if there is if there's issues with a certain route, we may request that a camera go on that bus for
that's
a certain amount
of days.
That's
what I was going to say. That's
yes.
What we used to have.
But,
is that,
right, but I think
we had a dummy camera in the right. Bus and
but I think
they didn't know if it was the real one or the right one.
But I think Mr. Hall is saying, you know, is we may want to go to constant monitoring of the bus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Before we would go to a physical monitor. I was thinking more about monitoring the students than monitoring the driver. But
and oddly enough, it may cost more to have a constant electronic monitoring system than another
person.
So that's something we'll have to measure.
Well, you know, when there's an issue, when something does happen,
mm-hmm.
you can... you go through it very quickly, and you can actually mm-hmm. pick the time in the second, you know, like the 23.44, and actually see the activity in motion.
And I think it's very powerful, too. I've had this in other districts that I've been in, because it does eliminate the student said, the driver said
right.
kind of issue. And I think a lot of times our contractor could be surprised with their employee behavior, and I think some of our parents would be surprised with some of the student behavior.
Yeah.
So,
no.
Yeah.
My son wouldn't do that.
One of the problems is, though, you can't show other students. So, you know, you have to be very careful. I want to see it, and mm-hmm. you can't really show the other student, because that student has a right to their privacy.
Mm-hmm. I'd make the motion to adjourn, Mr. Chairman.
Are you done, Lynn?
Yeah, do you have anything else?
She said we're short. Cutting her right off.
Try to get
no, no, she just did
cutting
this.
The leg
when
right
I saw
off
her do
her.
This, I knew she was done.
All right, so we have a motion.
I will second that.
All in favor.
Aye.
Good night.